Compared to when I was a kid, anime is so easily accessible now, in enormous quantities through multiple legal avenues. It's hard enough to know where to start watching as an adolescent or an adult, but what about with children? Responsible parents curate their young children's viewing habits, so it's probably best not to begin with Death Note or Berserk if you want to raise well-adjusted, non-murderous kids. As parental leisure time is often limited, a 1,000-episode binge of One Piece is unsuitable. Movies with well-defined stories that end within 2 hours are your best bet. Studio Ghibli's fantastic movies are usually the go-to source for family-friendly anime entertainment, but they are so well-publicized even non-anime fans know about them. There are so many other great family movies produced by other studios that are worth sharing with your children, younger relatives, siblings, so here's a list. First, some rules. No Studio Ghibli or Ghibli-related movies. PG or below. Must be available legally in English. No pirating allowed. No components of media franchises, so no Pokemon, etc. Standalone films only. No sequels. Regardless of rating, a child must be able to understand the movie. So, let's get to it. Based on the novel by Tomohiko Morimi, who created the Tatami Galaxy, Night is Short, Walk on Girl, and The Eccentric Family, Studio Colorido's first feature-length movie is a beautiful, whimsical coming-of-age story that features a sweet intergenerational friendship between fourth-grader main character Aoyama and the unnamed adult woman he calls the Lady. Together with his friends, Aoyama investigates a weird floating watery space-time anomaly that materializes in the countryside near his home. Somehow an army of penguins is involved, and the scenes of the funny penguins rampaging through the streets. I mean, that's enough said. A lighthearted but occasionally melancholy fairy tale, Penguin Highway leaves a potent, bittersweet aftertaste after its gorgeous, evocative ending song. As many successful Disney films can attest, parental death is a potent storytelling device in children's movies. Death is an inevitable part of life, so I think it's important that children are introduced to the concept early in a sensitive and honest fashion. Oko's Inn is a delightful film that deals with death in a matter-of-fact, emotional, yet slightly fantastical way. Based on a series of children's novels, the film follows young Oriko Oko Sikai as she recovers from the motor vehicle accident that claimed her parents' lives and damaged her memory. Moving to live with her grandmother and her family-run inn, Oko discovers that she can see the friendly ghosts who haunt the establishment. Gradually, Oko learns to come to terms with her personal tragedy through the help of her extended family, the inn's guests, and her supernatural friends. It's a fairly low-key film, and the associated TV show from 2018 has never been licensed in English, but the movie stands alone and works well as an examination of grief and loss that even young children can understand. Essentially, Agoraphobia, the movie, if you're at all disturbed by wide open spaces, Patima Inverted may be best watched accompanied by a stiff whiskey and through clasped fingers. It's a compelling adventure where rebellious dreamer and high school student, E.G., meets the mysterious Patima, a girl of similar age whose gravity is inverted. In their first scene together, he finds her clinging on for dear life to a flimsy metal fence to prevent herself from falling upwards into the empty blue sky. From this intriguing setup, Patima Inverted expands its fantasy world, where the laws of physics don't quite match our own, and one person's safe place may be another's source of abyssal terror. A masterclass of skillful direction with weird angles and perspective changes enhancing the characters and viewers' spatial discombobulation. Watch this one gripping tightly to your child, or at least to the arms of your sofa. Anyone who grew up in the 1980s watching Star Blazers or Captain Harlock and the Queen of a Thousand Years will instantly recognize the distinctive Leiji Matsumoto character designs in this unusual musical movie. Released in 2003, it compiles every animated video from Daft Punk's 2001 Discovery album into a single hour-long narrative. That it succeeds in telling a compelling, though simple story without the use of spoken dialogue is nothing short of miraculous. The Crescendo Dolls are a four-piece alien rock band who are abducted by an evil record company mastermind, leaving them with their memories wiped, their skin airbrushed, and their music cynically repackaged for Earth's music industry. A lone spaceman sets out to rescue them from corporate slavery, a biting satire on the manufactured fakery endemic to the music business, as well as an exciting action-filled space fantasy. It also has an incredible soundtrack. Only loosely associated with Fritz Lang's legendary 1927 film, director Rintaro's 2001 anime version instead adapts Osamu Tezuka's manga of the same name, itself only tenuously connected to the original film. It's a heady movie with a screenplay by Akira's Katsuhiro Otomo that makes up in spectacle for what it lacks in cohesive plot. With elements of Tezuka's Astro Boy melded with overt references to 1927's Metropolis, it begins like a detective story lifted from one of Isaac Asimov's robot tales. For those familiar with Tezuka's works, it's filled with his recurring star system characters that give the movie an attractive retro-futuristic look. Set in a sprawling multi-level city where humans and androids coexist, it follows the friendship between private detective Shunsaku Ban's nephew Kenichi and the female android Tima against a background of social unrest and revolution. Filled with truly spectacular set pieces, this is one of the most beautiful anime movies ever made. And now for something really quite obscure. Princess Arete is a 2001 movie from Studio 4 Degrees C, known for the recent stunning animated Children of the Sea that's based on Diana Cole's story, The Clever Princess, a feminist deconstruction of the patriarchal passive princess archetype so common in European fairy tales. Although largely forgotten in the West, in Japan it's a widely read story popular enough to justify this movie adaptation. The young princess rails against the patriarchal demands of her society, refusing to marry any of the suitors presented to her. A wicked wizard robs her of free will and steals her away to marry him instead, but she rebels. Only by seizing her own destiny, using her intelligence and empathy, does she succeed. A downbeat film with a very earthy color palette and almost European art style, this anime doesn't even look like an anime. The finale's monstrous golem and a golden mechanical bird-shaped aeroplane provide some striking imagery through the central act of the film is quite slow. It's only available subtitled, but there are many lengthy sections without dialogue that rely on visual storytelling anyway. Still, it's a shame that there's no dub. Thematically similar to Grave of the Fireflies, Giovanni's Island is an only slightly less traumatic examination of the effects of post-war on the lives of affected children. Set in the formerly Japanese island of Shikotan, it was annexed by the Russians in 1945, and by 1949 every Japanese resident had been removed. This is a fictionalized account of the people affected. Junpei and Kanta are children who lived through the Russian occupation of their home, and through them we see the effects of forced cultural assimilation, prejudice, and incarceration of rebels. It starts in quiet, almost slice-of-life pastoral comfort before descending into dark, cold tragedy. Despite this, there are many instances of warm humanity, even between supposed enemies. It helps to have some familiarity with the constantly referenced classic of Japanese literature or its anime adaptation, Night on the Galactic Railroad. Giovanni's Island is a sobering, thought-provoking film that invites children to learn empathy for those different to them. When shy 11-year-old Momo's father dies, she reluctantly moves with her mother to her family's home on an island in the Seto Inland Sea. Momo is resentful and standoffish, refusing to befriend the local kids, when she meets a trio of bizarre yokai, traditional Japanese folklore creatures. She's forced to come out of her shell. Culturally intriguing for a Westerner, Momo integrates many Shinto beliefs about death and the afterlife into the movie's plot. The rural island setting is well realized, and the town appears alive and lived in. Providing welcome, absurd, and sometimes broad slapstick humor, the three yokai help to lighten the tone of what otherwise might have been a heavy, melancholy movie. Suitable perhaps for slightly older children, younger kids might find their attention wandering when the yokai trio aren't up to mischief. Perhaps cheating slightly, being of Chinese origin rather than Japanese, Big Fish and Begonia still display significant anime influence, particularly in its character designs. Similar to A Letter to Momo, this deals with concepts of the afterlife that will seem alien to most Western viewers, and in my opinion, it makes the film more interesting. A thoroughly magical story, we follow Chun, a 16-year-old girl from a mystical realm where teenagers must undergo a rite of passage of transforming into a dolphin and spending a week in the human realm without coming into contact with humans. When she breaks the rules and rescues the soul of a drowned human boy, the effects are cataclysmically apocalyptic. Big Fish and Begonia is a beautiful fable about love, death, and sacrifice, with some utterly spectacular scenes of magical destruction. It's very important to watch until the end of the closing credits for a scene that magnificently recontextualizes the initially downbeat ending and everything that came before. Of all acclaimed director Mamoru Hosoda's films, only two are rated younger than 12 by the BBFC, which is a British rating system, but anyways. One is 2018's Mirai. The other is his tender, heartfelt 2012 ode to motherhood, Wolf Children. Hosoda's works often feature parents and children mixing a slice of life aesthetic with more fantastical elements. Understated in comparison to his virtual world movies, Summer Wars and Belle, Wolf Children is relatively grounded in its depiction of initially urban and then rural family life. Conscientious university student Hana falls in love with an unnamed man who is the last of the Wolfman hybrids. They conceive two children before he dies in a tragic accident, leaving Hana to care for two hybrid infants. Terrified that her neighbors, doctors, or social workers will discover her children's true natures, she moves them from their cramped apartment block to a remote farmstead. We follow the first 11 or so years of Hana's children, Yuki and Ami's lives, their conflicting personalities, and divergent choices. It's a movie about the self-sacrificial nature of motherhood, the search for identity and belonging, and the importance of community. Wolf Children's themes and the emotions they evoke are more important than the thin plot. We think it's probably one of his most widely accessible films, with strong moments that evoke universal feelings. This is far from a definitive list. There are plenty more lesser-known family-friendly anime movies available in English, but 10 is quite enough to be getting on with for now. Happy viewing, everyone, and please make sure you follow Anime News Network on all the different social media platforms, and don't forget to check out the A&N After Show. It's a wonderful little podcast where we talk about the most recent anime and some other epic topics, and that is always around 6 p.m. PT. So check it out. Bye!